I'm very pleased to welcome Cliff to speak tonight. Cliff is the executive chairman of Tekcapital, and he's passionate about the commercialization of universities and their discoveries. And he's founded three companies which subsequently listed, and he served as the CEO and chairman of HumanCAD, Solarius, Bellascura, which has recently been listed, Lucid and Guidon. He's got a very extensive history, experience of this. He's authored several books, including Too Good to Fail, Creating Marketplace Value from the World's Brightest Minds. Several of his products are included in the Smithsonian Institute exhibit on ergonomic design. And he's a fellow of the National Academy of Inventors and serves on the board of State University of New York at Empire State College. And he's, as well as his PhD from New York, he's an MBA from Oxford University. And I think today he's joining us from Miami. So I'm going to now hand over to him for his presentation, and I'll come back with the Q&A later.
Well, thank you, Cliff. I appreciate the kind introduction. We're on a very exciting journey to transform university discoveries into valuable products that could make a meaningful, positive impact to people's lives. Next slide, please. We create value from university discoveries. Three points I'd like to sort of emphasize is we build portfolio companies around technologies that we believe are compelling, that address white space in markets greater than $1 billion, and if successful, can improve the quality of life of the customers of those companies. We also feel it's critically important to combine with this intellectual property, star power management, that have a track record of being able to successfully navigate complex markets with well-entrenched incumbents. Additionally, we provide technology transfer services to more than 250 leading research institutions around the world. We have a multi-year track record of producing significant growth of our net assets. Our returns on invested capital last year were 23%. And we also have a multi-year track record of producing profitability. Next slide, please. Our most recent financial results for the year 2020 showed an increase in net assets of about 45% to $32.7 million, which is a record for the company. Our total revenue was $9.9 million. And our profit after tax was $7.7 million. So the company is performing well. We are increasing the value of our portfolio companies by steadfastly focusing on helping them be successful in their markets. Next slide, please. We have built what we think is the largest network of global university IP. It spans over 160 countries and more than 4,500 research institutions. And we're able to capture from these institutions IP that's available for sale or license in every area of science, medicine, and engineering. Additionally, we have approximately 60 scientists under contract to us that we can utilize when appropriate to screen these properties, at least for the initial due diligence. So our business model is about transforming IP into valuable products, which is a complex process, and it requires not only a great deal of skill, it requires a great deal of patience. Next slide, please. We have formed four portfolio companies, all of which are doing well, all of which I might add are salubrious, and that if they are successful in executing their business models, they can make a meaningful impact on the health of people worldwide. Our first portfolio company was Belliscura, which, as I'm sure you know, has recently floated quite successfully and currently has a market cap of around $86 million. And we're very happy that they've been able to do that, of course, but we're happier still with what they have done in terms of developing what we believe is the most advanced portable oxygen concentrator in the world, which is a wonderful achievement for a young business. Belliscura addresses the problems that people have who have COPD, where they need supplemental oxygen, and their device allows people to get supplemental oxygen in a small, portable, lightweight package that has user-replaceable filter cartridges. So it's a very exciting product that they've developed. They have it FDA cleared, and hopefully in the next couple of months they'll be in production and be able to supply these products to the customers that need them around the world, initially in the US, of course. Solaris, another one of our portfolio companies, owns the patented process for producing the world's smallest edible salt crystals. And small in this particular case is beautiful because small dissolves rapidly on the tongue. And the rapid dissolution of the salt on the tongue produces an overarching large sensation of saltiness in the brain. And so as a result, you could use less salt and get the same level of saltiness. How much less? It really depends on the product you're applying it to. But in the case of crisps and pretzels, for example, about 50% less sodium for the same level of saltiness. In the case of popcorn, it's about 70% less sodium for the same level of saltiness. And Solaris is manufacturing the salt. It's all natural, it's non-GMO, it's kosher, and it tastes like real salt because it is real salt. So we're very excited about the prospects of Solaris. We'll talk more about them in a bit. And Tekcapital owns about 97% of Solaris. Lucid makes smart eyewear. Lucid makes proper prescription glasses and sells them online and has just started to sell them in retail. And these glasses are lightweight, comfortable, stylish, very affordable at $150 a pair. Plus, they allow you to remain connected to your digital life. And we think that's what the way eyewear will be in the future. It'll not only correct and protect your vision, it'll allow you to maintain connectivity so you can make and take calls, listen to music, talk to Siri, Alexa, Google Voice, etc., all through glasses that look and function like normal, proper prescription glasses and sunglasses. Lucid is making remarkable strides, and we're very excited about the progress of the business, and we'll talk more about that in a few moments. We own 100% of Lucid and about 75% of Innovative Eyewear, which is an operating subsidiary of Lucid in the United States. Guidant makes software for improving the safety of autonomous vehicles. Everybody knows that autonomous vehicles are coming, and in particular, autonomous delivery devices. These are smaller vehicles, ground-based, that will deliver medicine, food, pizzas, what have you. There will be no driver in the vehicle, and they will enable companies to reduce the cost of deliveries and improve the availability of products 24/7. Autonomous vehicles are inherently safer than regular vehicles, but there will be mishaps. And when those mishaps occur, there often won't be anybody in the vehicle to help resolve those mishaps. And so you will need to hook those vehicles up telemetrically to a remote monitoring and control center where a virtual operator can be dropped into an adverse situation and either call a first responder or move the vehicle out of harm's way, take it off the roadway, et cetera. And all this will be done with telemetrically controlled remote monitoring software. So Guidant is making that software, has demonstrated the software to work, and is building the first remote monitoring and control center in the state of Florida as we speak. And we own 100% of Guidant. So what these four companies have in common is if they are successful in executing their business models, they can improve the lives of the customers they serve. They address markets north of $1 billion, in some cases considerably north of $1 billion currently. They have compelling intellectual property in our reckoning, and they have star power management. Next slide, please. So we'll talk briefly about Belascura. This was our first portfolio company. They've done a wonderful job developing the Explorer device, which was cleared by the FDA in March of this year. And their recent flotation was quite successful. We have Belascura on the books in the end of 2020 at approximately $2 million. And that stake is worth approximately $13 million today. And we're very pleased with the company and the progress that they've made. And the most redeeming feature about the business from our perspective is the replaceable filter cartridges in the portable oxygen concentrator that Belascura has developed and got cleared will allow people to upgrade their portable oxygen concentrators as their disease progress. And they'll be able to upgrade it much as you would upgrade memory on a laptop. And what this will do is it will make portable oxygen concentrators more affordable for the millions of people around the world that need them. And so we really think the market for the product is extraordinary. It's estimated to be over $5 billion in the next 5 years. And aside from the 300 million people that have COPD, which is enough of a market in and of itself, with the unfortunate occurrence of COVID-19, many of the individuals who survived it have displayed residual lung scarring and inflammation that necessitates the use of supplemental oxygen. So the growth of the market is projected to be around 10% a year. And we think that Belascura is in a wonderful position with potentially the most cost-effective device in the world to help address the need for supplemental oxygen. Next slide, please. Lucid makes proper prescription glasses and sells them all over the world on its website and on Amazon.com. But these glasses enable you, through Bluetooth connectivity, enable you to connect to your phone or your PC or your smartwatch, I might add, and allow you, by using your voice, to take and make calls, listen to music, talk to Siri, order an Uber, send cash to a friend, all through your glasses. And there's nothing in the ear because the small speakers are on the back part of the temples, but they don't actually occupy your ear canal. And this is actually a wonderful feature because it allows you to maintain situational awareness. Why is that important? Every 88 minutes in the United States, a pedestrian is killed. And in most instances, it's due to both the pedestrian and drivers alike being distracted on their smartphones. And the distraction comes in two flavors. It comes in either looking at your phone by sending texts or reading messages, or by listening to music and having a device in your ear canal like AirPods or earbuds that prevent you from hearing the traffic around you. So with Lucid glasses, you can listen to music, take and make calls, send messages all with your voice without having to take your phone out of your pocket. And there's nothing in your ear canal, so you can maintain situational awareness. So aside from the glasses being proper prescription and connected to your digital life, we think they're inherently safer. And as a result, we think in the future, most, if not all, glasses will be smart glasses, will be Bluetooth enabled. And there's three features that are important in the selling of glasses. They have to look good because you're putting them on your face. They have to be comfortable, and the proxy for comfort is weight. Traditional glasses weigh about an ounce, and Lucid glasses weigh just a tad over an ounce. In fact, their new titanium front frame glasses weigh almost exactly an ounce. And they have to be priced the same. And the MSRP for the Lucid glasses is $149 in sunglass format. So Lucid has finally made a pair of Bluetooth-enabled glasses that are ready for mass market, because they're able to check all three boxes. They look great. They have technology, but don't cost any more than regular glasses. And they're comfortable, so you can wear them all day, which is critical, especially if you have prescription glasses like I wear and 60% of the world wears, where you need to wear the glasses all day. So Lucid has really raised the bar in the smart eyewear industry, and we think they're producing a product that customers are really enjoying. They've sold several thousand of these products, and they've recently expanded their team, and they plan to penetrate the optical markets of the world, and they've just started to do that, and they're planning to go into big box distribution as well to expand their sales dramatically over the next 3 years. Next slide, please. Lucid is also fortunate to have the brand ambassador, Richard Sherman, who's an NFL star. And they also are bringing on other brand ambassadors in other sports and entertainment verticals. They've recently added Hada Adora, who's an up-and-coming a music superstar. And they've recently added a pro golfer. And they will continue to add influencers for all of the key demographics and cohorts that are prospective customers for their products. Next slide, please. Solaris, which is Latin for salt, owns a patented process for producing micron-sized salt crystals. And these crystals are roughly 100 times smaller than typical table salt. And they dissolve incredibly quickly on the tongue and produce a large sensation of saltiness. So you could use less salt on surface applications such as snack foods. The reason why this is important is the number one cause of premature death in the world is cardiovascular disease. 17.9 million people die each year prematurely, according to the World Health Organization, from cardiovascular disease. And many of these deaths can be prevented through diet and exercise, and in particular, through the reduction of sodium consumption. In the United States, the average biped consumes 3,400 milligrams, adult biped consumes 3,400 milligrams of sodium per day. The US FDA has estimated that if that amount could be reduced to 2,300 milligrams a day, it would save in the United States alone 25,000 lives a year. To do this, food companies need to reduce the sodium in their products. And it's a difficult proposition because if you're manufacturing foods, and snack foods in particular, it's all about flavor. And you don't want to do anything that ameliorates the flavor because that's why people are buying the product. So what Solaris has done is they have developed the first all-natural low-sodium, non-GMO salt that will allow snack food companies to reduce the sodium in the product without affecting the flavor one iota. And we have done a taste test to compare and ascertain this to be correct. They have also done a proof of concept manufacturing program to make their own crisps called Salt Me Crisps, which are being sold online and in stores in the US. The customers love them. About 73% of the respondents on Amazon gave them a 5-star ratings. So the customers love the low sodium salt. They love it because it tastes just like salt that they're accustomed to and they enjoy consuming on their snack foods. And they love it because it has half the sodium. And so Solaris aims to make a dent in the cardiovascular disease occurrence by reducing the sodium consumption in a wide variety of snack foods. Solaris is also in the process of putting together the first low-sodium, all-natural, non-GMO kosher salt packets, which will be launched in the autumn. And we believe they'll be sold all over the world at food services, convenience stores, natural food stores, and in restaurants. So just like you might consume a package of a low-calorie sugar substitute like Splenda, you will be able to have a packet of a low-sodium salt substitute, but in this case, it's an all-natural salt substitute like Microsalt. And so we're very excited about the future potential of Microsalt. Recently, they onboarded Dr. Jay Shah, who is a cardiologist at the world-renowned Mayo Clinic, and he's the medical advisor for the company. And we're thrilled that he's part of the team and helping to guide the efforts. And we hope to see Microsalt and Solaris into production of their low-sodium packets in the September-October timeframe. And we also hope to see them onboarded by a major snack food company before year's end. Next slide, please. Solaris is fortunate to have a very capable team. On the board is Eduardo Suchin, who is the brand manager for Pringles, the fourth largest snack food business in the world, and Steve McCready, who is the director of product development at Albertsons, which is a major supermarket chain. They have 2,300, second largest supermarket chain in North America after Kroger. They have 2,300 supermarkets. And he and his team were responsible for all the private labeled snack foods for all 2,300 stores. And then running the company as CEO is Victor Manzanella, whom we hired, who was previously for a decade at Procter & Gamble. He ran the Febreze unit, amongst other important assignments. So they really have a world-class team for an early stage business with a great deal of experience in making and selling billions of dollars worth of snack foods each year. So we hope to see some very significant progress from Solaris over the course of 2021. And finally, but certainly not least, is guidance. So Guidant makes software to improve the safety of autonomous vehicles. And Guidant also has a very deep patent portfolio for an early stage business. They have 7 patents and more in the works. And they have demonstrated their MVP. And they have built what we believe is the lowest latency remote monitoring and control center anywhere in the world. And hopefully we'll see in the next few months that they prove that out and they're able to onboard customers. In the state of Florida, it's now a law. If you want to operate an autonomous vehicle without a driver, you have to be able to hook it up telemetrically to a remote monitoring and control center. So we're building that first center in Boca Raton, Florida. Additionally, just recently, 2 weeks ago, California passed the same law, requiring remote monitoring and control for autonomous vehicles without safety drivers. And 3 weeks ago, Angela Merkel in Germany put forward the same law, requiring throughout Germany that if you're going to operate an autonomous vehicle, and that includes delivery drones, without a safety driver, you have to have telemetric monitoring as a safety backup system. And that law was just recently passed by the lower house of parliament in Germany. And it's subsequently, it seems likely it will be passed by the upper house. And so Germany will be the first country in the world that countrywide has the requirement for remote monitoring and control for autonomous vehicles. The first autonomous vehicles that are going to come on stream in large numbers will be these autonomous delivery devices. The reason why we believe that to be the case is a combination of physics and finance. From your early physics classes, I'm sure you remember that momentum is mass times velocity. Well, the mass of the autonomous delivery devices is a lot less than the mass of a traditional vehicle. And the velocity is usually limited to 25 or 30 miles an hour. So the momentum that the vehicle, that's an autonomous delivery device, can impart to objects or pedestrians is less. So they're inherently safer. That's the physics. The economics is autonomous delivery of groceries, medicines, and other supplies will dramatically reduce the cost of those deliveries and the availability of those products. So we believe autonomous delivery drones will be occupying the streets of most major cities of the world over the next year or so. And we also believe that just like in Florida and California and Germany and other jurisdictions, most jurisdictions that are sensible will require these vehicles to hook up telemetrically to a remote monitoring and control center that can not only monitor the vehicles, but can intercede in the case of a mishap, can call a first responder, can speak with pedestrians through the vehicle, and can actually take over control of the vehicle and move it out of harm's way into a car park or away from a harmful site. And Guidant is developing that technology. They've demonstrated it, and they have a remarkable team for an early stage business. Next slide, please. We're very pleased to announce that heading up Guidant is Harald Braun. Harald was formerly the CEO of Siemens Nokia Networks, which is a major company in the networking space. They had 4,000 employees in Boca Raton, Florida. And joining Harald is Johan Denishin, who is the current COO of Volkswagen North America. And Johan has a very storied career, has had a very storied career in the automotive industry. 2 years ago, he was executive vice president of General Motors and president of the Cadillac Group. And prior to that, he was president of Audi USA and Audi Japan and the Infiniti car companies. He's extremely knowledgeable, to say the least, about the car industry. And joining Johan and Harald is Daniel Grossman, who was one of the early founders of Zipcar. He built out the brand globally before it was acquired by Avis Budget. He then was asked by General Motors to run as COO their first mobility company called Maven. And Guidant has onboarded Daniel both as a director and chief revenue officer for the business. So all three of these individuals have run billion-dollar businesses, and their competencies are synergistic and complementary. Harold's in the telecommunications space, Johan's in the automotive space, and Daniel is in the mobility space, which I view as necessary core competencies for remote monitoring and control operations. Next slide, please. We have a small board at Tekcapital, but I'm honored to have Robert Miller, the Right Honorable Lord David Willits, and Louis Castro on the board, joining me on the board. Dr. Miller was the vice chairman of the Mayo Clinic. He's a radiation oncologist, and he's also a professor now of radiation oncology at the University of Tennessee at Knoxville. The Right Honorable Lord Willits, who I'm sure many of you know or have heard of, was the former Minister for Universities and Science in the United Kingdom. He served as a Member of Parliament for 23 years, and he was President of the British Science Association. Extraordinarily knowledgeable gentleman, and in particular knowledgeable about the path necessary for the commercialization of university discoveries and how they can impact economic development. And then Louis Castro, who's an experienced investment banker, he's floated over 50 companies, and he's a chartered accountant. So I'm grateful to the board for their guidance and leadership for our business. Next slide, please. In summary, Tekcapital commercializes university discoveries, transforms them actually, for our own portfolio and as a service for our university clients. We have built a high-value portfolio of four diverse companies, small in number but diverse in focus: Velasquez, Lucid, Solaris, and Guidant, delivering significant growth of our net assets, significant returns of invested capital, 23% last year, and profitability. Thank you very much, and I'm very happy to try to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much, Cliff. Start my video. Thank you, Cliff, very much for that presentation, which was a very detailed review of your portfolio. And we've got quite a lot of questions actually coming through. So let's go straight into them.
Great.
Pankaj Patel, he says, it's important to show a future roadmap for each of the portfolio companies, like the content in Bellascura's AIM admission document. So is there a plan to do this for the other portfolios? Is it imminent? And this will give a more compelling investment case for prospective investors, he asks. That's a good question I'd like to ask myself as well. Excellent question.
Yeah, it is a good question. The short answer is yes. The modified answer is when. And it really depends on the particular opportunities facing each of those companies. We believe, and this is sort of obvious, that we've built these companies not to be in-house occupants, but to either be acquired or floated as standalone enterprises. And so depending on the competitive landscape, there's certain information that we can disclose and certain information that's best not to be disclosed for competitive purposes. So suffice it to say, over time, the roadmaps for all the companies will become known. Of course, Belisquera's roadmap is known because they've made a proper public disclosure, as one would expect for a listed company.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
And the next question, I think you said 4,500 research institutions, but you've only actually got four products, which we've on the goers, I think. And the question really is are you planning to invest in more university investment ideas, or will you dissolve Tekcapital after the current investments go public? And that's Siddha Bhaskar's asked that question.
Okay, good question. Overarching concept, discretion is the better part of valor. There's a Chinese expression that you could build a pretty good meal out of a lot of small fish, but we rather prefer the Sunday roast. So we think fewer companies that we could hunker down with and really help guide to become successful and major disruptors in their space is good for two reasons. It helps increase the likelihood that they can actually make a difference in people's lives. And it helps increase the likelihood that our returns on invested capital could be quite significant, a la Belisquera, $2 million on the books, $13 million in hand. So I think it's not a question of more being better. It's a question of executing properly and success being better. And so we plan to focus on the companies we have until we get to a point where we could see that the companies are in fact generating good returns. And then, as we have previously announced, our plan is to execute a special dividend for our good and patient shareholders. And at that point in time, we'll make a decision as to what additional companies we want to add to the portfolio. We are, of course, always scouting for that next company, but we do so carefully.
Thank you. And the net asset value, I think, is mentioned 35 cents a share. I'm not sure if that's pre Belisquera or post.
Yeah, that's pre, and that's correct. It's 32.7 million is our NAV, and you could divide that.
And I think in English terms, that's about 25p a share.
Correct.
And the share price, you'll be pleased to know, is up 5% today. That must be coming on here, Cliff.
Well, it's because of the other Cliff.
Now, being serious, and the question coming is the November 30th NAV value is inaccurate. Can you provide us an updated estimate of what you think the current NAV is?
Well, I mean, we don't release financial results between periods. That would be an awful precedent and inappropriate. But one can do back of the envelope arithmetic. And so if you take our reported NAV for the end of 2020, which is 32.7 million, and you record the uplift in the Belisquera valuation, and you subtract the exercise price for the warrants and options, and you add the residual cash that we collected in the recent placings, you can impute that our NAV, I'll do the arithmetic for you.
Thank you.
You could impute that the NAV would be around $40 million, give or take.
Okay. So somewhat higher than the 35 cents it was. Thank you very much. I'm sure everybody's going to be working that one through as well. And the next question, Siddharth again, actually. Solarius sounds like a no-brainer for snack manufacturers. I rather think the same, yeah. What's the key challenge or pain point that management is trying to address currently? Is there an inflection point where suddenly this really sort of goes zooming through?
Yes, I think when you get really close to it and you realize that cardiovascular disease is the number one killer in the world, it's not COVID, it's heart disease. And you realize that 70% of premature deaths from heart disease can be prevented by diet and exercise, and in particular by reducing sodium consumption, which reduces hypertension, which is the leading risk factor for developing heart disease. It becomes obvious that we need to reduce sodium, and we writ large need to reduce sodium consumption worldwide. It's a worldwide problem. And many countries have started to require front of label packaging, like Mexico did last October, where if you have more than a certain level of sodium, you have to put excess sodium warning labels on the front of the package, just as you would have to put warning labels on cigarette packets. And many countries have started, like Chile, to legislate sodium reduction in their snack foods. We think this is on trend. The manufacturers of the food products are not the villains. They want to make better for you products that the customers enjoy. That's how they grow their business, and they know that's the trend. The trick has been they haven't had a salt to do it with, because the other there are low sodium salts on the market, but they usually use potassium chloride. And potassium chloride works in terms of reducing your sodium, although it increases your potassium consumption. But potassium chloride, unfortunately, has a metallic flavor. And so you have to live with that, or you have to mask it with other chemicals to hide it. So it's not an all natural, it's not a clean label product when you start masking it with other chemicals. And it doesn't quite taste the same as sodium chloride, which is why the low sodium products have not done well in the marketplace. And as a result, the snack food companies are skittish about salt replacements until they can prove to themselves that they not only taste great, but the customers will continue to buy them in the quantities that they're currently buying them in. Now, we think Microsalt is the first actual practical workable solution for that quagmire. But for snack food companies to onboard it, they have to go through extensive testing, not only sodium testing, but consumer-facing testing. And we think it's something like this. Once the first major snack food company, pardon the pun, bites on it, the others will follow suit because they'll realize the water is safe. And so we think it'll be a binary uplift. And it's that first one or two major companies that are key. In the meantime, consumers want low sodium anyway. And so Solaris will be packaging low sodium salt in its native form and selling it as salt packets, much as you would get a packet of Splenda if you wanted to reduce your caloric consumption. You'll be able to get a packet of Microsalt to reduce your sodium consumption. So one way or another, the market will embrace this product in our reckoning. And we believe Solaris and its Microsalt operating division in the US will become a major player in the low sodium market.
And have you been able to persuade some of these manufacturers to try some samples and test it in some geographies?
Yes, yes, we have. The publicly announced number is about 25, but it's actually considerably in excess of that. 25 large companies are testing the product as we speak. And they've asked for not little samples to test, but significant quantities to test. And some companies have sent us train loads of snacks to apply the chips to and have them independently tested. So the testing is ongoing. It'll probably take a couple more months, but it'll come to, in our reckoning, we believe it'll come to a very positive conclusion.
Okay, well, that gives an indication of timing for that question. Thank you. Can we expect some forward-looking broker forecasts soon? I don't think you have any broker forecasts out there. It makes it difficult for individual investors to get a handle on your company.
Those are not forthcoming. And because it's difficult to do in earnest and not by accident be disingenuous. So with early stage businesses, you know, it's often binary in nature. You can go from zero to 50 million pretty quickly if you hit it right, or more. And which is, of course, our hope for all of our companies. What we do hope is that within the next couple of years, all of the companies are sold or floated. And between now and then, they will have to demonstrate that they're able to hit tangible milestones in terms of sales and production and satisfy the needs of their customers. But providing forecasts at this juncture is, I think it wouldn't be a useful exercise because it's difficult to do earnestly.
Yeah, okay. And a related question actually is, the NAV appears to be determined by TEK itself. Is it feasible that the method used by TEK inflates the NAV to excess compared to a valuation that might be arrived at by independent organizations? So there's a couple of points to that, but independent.
Yeah, I'll just address it head on straight away. The value of our portfolio companies is determined by one of three methods. If the stock is quoted, it's the closing price at the end of the period observed on the exchange that it's quoted on. The stock is not quoted, it's independently valued by outside independent valuation experts that are approved by our auditors, not by TEK. If it's not valued by independent valuation experts, we can value the stock based on a third-party arm's length investment that was done in the company, such as we did with Belascura prior to its flotation. It had conducted a number of third-party investment rounds, some of which we participated in a minor way, some of which we didn't. And we would normally tie the valuation of Belascura historically to the price of the most recent observed arm's length investment round. So either observed independent investment, independent valuation by auditor-approved third-party independent valuation firms, or quoted stock price at the end of the period, full stop. Is it inflated? No, actually, we think it's rearward looking. Our numbers for 2020 are at the end of November. At the end of November, Belascura was $2 million on our balance sheet. Today, it's $13 million. Would you say we inflated it? I think not.
Okay. Yeah. And I think, if I remember rightly, the accounts have got quite a detailed explanation, I mean, the notes of how these valuations work.
Yeah, we try to be as thorough as possible.
Yeah, thank you.
Of course.
Right, we've done that one. And TEK raises cash via placings on a very, very regular basis. I'm not sure about very regular basis, but it certainly has done so. I think the question, Andrea says, four in the last 18 months. And this seems to provide risk of dilution for existing holders. And especially if they cannot participate themselves. And I noticed that last time, yeah.
Well, I think that's mostly accurate. It's not really that frequent, and the amounts have been very modest. Remember, we've only raised about $12 million, including our IPO since inception. And yet we've produced, 40 million dollars in net assets, depending on how you look at it. So our returns on invested capital have been actually quite handy. It's not how much capital you raise, it's what you do with the capital and how well you're able to produce returns on invested capital. And remember, we're an IP investment firm. We're supposed to invest capital. That's what we do for a living. We capture university innovations that we think are worth the carriage. We form portfolio companies around those innovations, and we try to help guide them to a successful endpoint, either an acquisition or a flotation or something, the moral equivalent of those two. And to do that, you need capital as well as IP. You also need talented team members, and we've been very fortunate in that regard.
Can we expect more fundraisers over the next few years? Will you need to grow these companies?
It's different. We obviously don't pre-announce fundraisers in advance, right? If only there was such clarity in the world. It really will depend on how those companies perform. If the companies perform well, and let's say one of them gets acquired for a couple $100 million, I would say there won't be any more fundraisers, full stop.
Yeah.
Okay.
Got a few more questions coming through.
Sure.
The question about the risk profile, you've only got four portfolio companies, and most seem to be low pre-revenue companies. Would you like to react to that statement? And is the company planning to address any of this risk? I presume they mean by diversifying, but that's Andrea. Andrea M. asked that question.
Yeah. I don't think diversification mitigates risk. It might using portfolio theory, but when you talk about early stage investing, I do believe less is more. And having a portfolio, and I've had portfolio, I've had portfolios of 75, 100 companies. I don't think it does much service to the shareholders over time. It may sound good, it may look good, but it's better to be focused because you really need a knowledge edge to create a competitive advantage in markets today. And that's only doable with a small number of companies, if that. So the risk profiles are high for early stage businesses, and ours are not an exception to that. But the way we mitigate the risk is a couple things. One, by having a very large network to select IP from, you mitigate adverse selection bias. You don't neutralize it, but you mitigate it. But the number one tool for mitigating risk is hiring star power management. Because you know, however good the technology is, if you don't have capable, inspired executives, it'll often be wasted. And so we believe we've done a yeoman's job, not to flatter ourselves, in hiring above average, highly experienced, in some cases, even illustrious managers for these early stage businesses, which is challenging. But we've been able to do that. And we think as a result, yes, the risks are high. One could think of them as binary, but Belisquera managed to plow through it successfully, and we reckon the other three will do the same, but time will tell.
Thank you. And back to the salt question, fast food outlets like McDonald's and Burger King are always on the lookout to making their offerings healthier. Will you be targeting these types of restaurants to use microsalt on their fries?
We will be targeting all restaurants to purchase microsalt packets so the consumers can apply salt more judiciously and with lower sodium.
Okay. When can you expect Belisquera to start bringing in revenues? What's the sales channel strategy?
Well, that's really best a question to ask of them. They are fully independent.
Now they're floated. Company. Yeah.
I would take their word for that. What they've said publicly is fairly shortly they'll be in production in the looks like in the autumn, but clarification should come from them directly, not through us.
Thank you. Yeah, quite right. There's a question how many shares you own at the moment. I think it's 8.7 million, isn't it?
Yeah, give or take. Plus, I have options for 3 million additional ones.
Okay. And there's a lock-in with Belisquera. Michael Robertson wants to know about that.
Yes. Under AIM Rule 7, if you own more than 10% of a company that floats, you normally have a hard lock of 12 months. The only way around that is death. So I'd rather not navigate that particular pathway. And then after that, it'll be an orderly market. But we're not in any rush to sell because we think the best days are in front of it. Remember, this is the first time in the history of the world there's actually a genuine oxygen shortage in many countries. And they have a world-class, if not superior, device. So we think it's going to be a very good path for Belisquera going forward. It's a wonderful company. They have a wonderful product at the best time probably in the history to have such a product. Exciting.
It is, yeah. My next door neighbor to along had to have oxygen, so I know about it. I've seen it personally. And very sad when it's needed, but very essential product.
And yeah, makes activities of daily living doable.
Yeah. Andrea asks about primary bid. I don't know if you know about primary bid in the UK, but they allow fundraisings for small investors to participate in quite easily. They've been doing quite well over the last year in facilitating that. And will you be considering using them in the future fundraisers so that individual investors can participate as well as larger?
No, we haven't investigated doing that.
Well, hopefully you will, Cliff, but in future.
hopefully it won't be necessary.
That's the other way around. Yes, thank you. Amazon are looking, we've got a few minutes left, let's just wrap up. Sure. Amazon are looking to use delivery, land and air drones, but safety is an issue for them. Is Guiden a solution for them? Are you talking to them?
Guidant is producing an agnostic solution for any operator of autonomous vehicles or delivery devices. And they're building a managed service business, sort of software as a service, autonomous vehicle monitoring and control as a service. And I am not talking to any of the companies. Guidant is running as a separate company, but they are reaching out to, if not all, most of the autonomous vehicle and autonomous delivery device operators in the world.
And I've got a personal question, Cliff. Sure. Warren Buffett question. What's your succession plan? Are you going to carry on to your 89 or something, or what?
What's my succession plan?
And tallied to that is how much of this company is around you, you know, as investors. Are we buying you or buying something else?
Well, it's a small team. I don't want to overstate it. We don't have the enormous depth of bench, but we have a capable team that works, we think, not only synergistically, but to a good end. We don't have a succession plan in place as of yet, but over time we will, of course, have one. Right now, I'm feeling kind of cherubic.
Absolutely. You're looking well. You're living sensibly in Florida as well.
Let me know where I send the £5.
and your investor base, I'm looking at this on Stockopedia. It seems to be rather individual, so there don't seem to be many many funds investing.
There are.
Am I misunderstanding that?
Yeah, well, you're misunderstanding it or they haven't included it. But in our last round, it was mostly institutional. So we probably have 20 institutions or family offices in the business.
Okay, and what percentage do you think that is owned by individuals as opposed to institutions?
I would be guessing, so I'd rather not throw out a number.
Right. Yeah. Well, I think that sort of wraps up all the questions we've got. I'm afraid Panjab's asking a question which we can't get an answer for, so I won't answer that one. And we've already answered that. So we're bang on time, I think, actually, Cliff. It's been a great run investing with you since I first met you in November 2018. I bought some shares at 5p. I bought some more later on at 11p and 8p and 11p. I wish you all the best going forward. So thank you very much for presenting, and hopefully you'll come back and give us an update in the future as well.
Well, thank you for the opportunity, and I appreciate the good questions as well.
Thank you. Pleasure. Good night, everybody.